host for the next hour and 45 minutes or so. We're on one of the most historic rides in our country. With over 700 people, we're going to have to eliminate a few night camps and entertainment. But as you well know, the most important thing is the ride itself. So ride with me now and I'll show you a different view of the 97 Boundary Commission wagon train.
That they had buffalo meat to eat. Still, great boiled buffalo meat. Oh, hard on the palate. They were attacked with diarrhea. That must have greatly weakened them. Not only did they eat boiled buffalo meat, using the dried dung for fuel on occasion were forced to drink diluted buffalo urine. Many of the lakes they stopped at were just puddles. Thousands of buffalo that had watered there all summer. And the only liquid found was what was left in the tracks made by the buffalo. This they'd dip out with a cup and boil, adding lots of tea. God, what a tasty, nauseating drink that must have been. Still, I guess after 3 or 4 days of no water, those thousands of little puddles would have been a welcome sight.
Thank you.
without mentioning names, if this wagon was on track in the 1800s, I think they'd have been among the first to be drinking that buffalo urine and scrounging around for buffalo scraps. Talk about you lightening the load in a hurry.
I'm from Weyburn. I'm not related to any of these guys. This is year five for me, too. And she's...
Captain Donald Roderick Cameron, the commissioner appointed by Canada, is in charge of all operations and travel back and forth along the line in Democrats with a single guy. 40 of the men were Royal Engineers from England. The others, surveyors, medical personnel, commissionary, scouts, guides, blacksmiths, teamsters, and cooks from Canada. There are even tailors and shoemakers. 4 of the engineers were photographers, and they were responsible for a comprehensive visual record of the survey. Ox trains moved the bulk of supplies forward along the main route. Then it was distributed to separate parties by horses and wagons. The supply trains moved steadily forward, and all other work depended on their delivery. The weather was pleasant for summer of 1874, and the work went smoothly. Under Anderson, the commission moved quickly along the line. As astronomical sightings were taken and the parallel determined, the line was run, and the width of 3 to 6 miles was surveyed on either side of the line. Stations were about 20 miles apart, but since the British and Americans took sightings at alternate stations, almost as much time was spent moving, unpacking, and setting up the camp as surveying. Although the parties only began work in early March, they had already passed the White Mud Depot on the Frenchman's River by early July. Life on the line was mostly work, but sometimes it was interrupted by a buffalo hunt or a visit to an Indian or Métis camp. Sunday was a day of rest and a day of writing and journals and reading. By the end of September 1874, the work of the Boundary Commission was completed, and the men were on their way home.
How goes the first day?
Oh, just wonderful.
It's been a long one.
You're from?
Oh, I'm Pat McCune. I'm from Sherwood Park, Alberta.
Marge Bouvier from Black Labiche, Alberta.
Carolyn Corian Hanborn from Coronation, Alberta.
Brian and Candy Sunt from Ogama, Saskatchewan.
Roland Broke from Perry, Saskatchewan.
Willard Johnson from Ogama, Saskatchewan.
Leroy Hanson from Paris.
Matt Herbert Ross from Seawall, Saskatchewan.
My name is Arla Hanson. I'm from Paris, Saskatchewan.
Having fun?
I'm here with my husband Leroy, and yes, we're having a dandy time.
Right on.
We brought some new friends with us this year, and it's first for them, that's exciting too.
Thank you.
Somewhere along the way, Commissioner French of the Army was introduced to a young half-breed guide named Jerry Potts. So French hired Jerry for $90 a month and moved with immense benefit to the fort. They had more or less wandered westward across the plains. Now they had a guide who proved the plainsman without parallel and would loyally serve until his death 22 years later. Sam Steele would summarize Jerry's guiding ability in these words: "A scout and a guide, I have never met his equal. He has none in either the Northwest or the States to the South." Potts was also an outstanding warrior whose early life illustrated the consequence of unlimited liquor mixed with the land of no law. He was the son of Andrew Potts, a scout employed by the American Fur Company, and a Blood Indian. While Potts was still a baby, his father was murdered by the pagan Indian. For the next few years, he was cared for by Alexander Harvey, a man whose contempt for Indians was typical of most plainsmen. Now, in the early 1840s, because his Negro employee had been murdered, he fired a cannon into a group of unsuspecting Blackfoot Indians, killing 13 of them. Whether or not the Blackfoot were guilty was of no interest to Harvey. 13 Indians, innocent or guilty, was the only just revenge as far as he was concerned. Fortunately for Potts, irate citizens forcefully urged Harvey to settle elsewhere. Potts was then cared for by an Andrew Dawson. He not only taught Jerry English and five Indian dialects, but instilled in him an understanding and pride for both his white and Indian heritage. Jerry also became a superb horseman and a superb shot with a six-gun rifle. Now in 1872, when Potts was in his early 30s, he learned that his half-brother had been murdered by a drunken Blood Indian named Good Young Man, and his mother was killed when she tried to retrieve her son's body. Jerry vowed revenge. After 2 months later, Good Young Man left camp to go hunting, and Jerry shot him. Potts also participated in many of the Indian battles that characterized the region until the police arrived, including the last major Indian battle on Canadian soil. Involved were the Blackfoot, the Bloods, the Crees, and the Assiniboines. The Crees started the fight by murdering several Blood squaws and a brother of Red Crow, the Blood Chief. Fortunately for the Crees, the Bloods and their allies were more plentiful and better armed. Once they recovered, they routed the attackers. The battle was fought near today's Left Bridge, and as the Crees attempted to escape by crossing the Old Man River, they were picked off by scores. Potts, who had been elected leader and led a final charge that routed the Crees, later recalled, "You could fire your eyes shut and still hit a Cree." Potts returned from the bloody affair with 19 grizzly scalps, a deep head in wound in his head, and an arrow in his body. He had won imperishable fame.
We got her.
How are you doing?
Saskatchewan.
And Donna?
Southside of Saskatchewan, City of Manitoba. Tom Lake.
Levitt, Basswood Manitoba. Senior Constable, Daryl Wawson, Rapid City, Manitoba.
I'm from Minnieberry's Alberta. I'm a rancher there. Just out here for a birthday present. Have some fun.
My name's Kaylee Elric. I'm Stan Elric's daughter. I'm from Minnieberry's too, and I'm just here to have fun.
Kaylee is my granddaughter. Stan is my son-in-law. I'm Jerry Stewart, and I was born and raised more or less in this country, and it's just been a great time. This is my husband, Stan Stewart.
Betty and Sam Switzer from Bragg Creek.
Jupiter.
I'm Romley Hudon from St.
Brian Norbert. This is my second ride, trail ride. I'm riding a new horse, and he's getting better and better every day. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Jason Gidon, and I come from Fort Garry, and this is my first trail ride, and this is my horse, Blum.
Hi, my name is Noe Bay, and I come from Seattle, and this is my first trail ride. This is my horse, my fair lady.
Lettuce from Calgary.
I'm Blaine from Cochrane.
I'm Joe from Cochrane.
Alan Kidd from Millet.
Very different from Cochrane.
Bruce McCroll, Canmore.
Cheryl McCroll, Canmore.
Hey, my name's Shelley Drew. I'm from Morden, Manitoba, and this is my horse, Joe.
Hi, I'm Gary Maloney. Manitoba.
Hi, I'm Karen. I'm Karen Kruger from Morden, Manitoba.
Hi, Bill Norrie from Treherne, Manitoba.
Just over there.
Now, for 50 cents a bag, you could have your feed hauled from the feed truck to your camp by Brutus here and his enterprising buddy.
This guy's gonna fight with the pig guy?
10, 15.
Alberta, and my first wife, Sunny, married 44 years, and Joe for the horse. Garvin Turner from Crockford Town, Magna.
Moore from High River, and this is Pepsi.
I'm Joyce Moore from High River, and this is Bandy.
Good morning.
We're the Cody family. We come from Skunk Lake, Saskatchewan. This is Henry, my husband. This is a great niece. Kaylee DeLorme from Robsart. Our oldest daughter, Colette Ackerman from Lloyd Minister. Her husband, Fred. Our son, David, and his wife, Leanne, from Lloyd.
Thank you.
Illinois.
Right from the start, eh?
Right on. We'll have to try and continue on right to the end, too.
I'm Mark Cruz. Manitoba.
I'm Jennifer Curry, and I'm from Alberta, Manitoba.
Having fun.
I'm Peter Bronson from High River, Alberta.
Blaze from Pinch Creek.
Christine Lang from Lethbridge.
Miara Winters from Milk River.
Rose Winters from Milk River.
Alvin Baskin from Coaldale.
Foremost.
Alec Burdett from Nagelma, Saskatchewan, and his wife Lorette, our grandson. Jordan McGarry from Medicine Hat, Dustin McGarry from Medicine Hat, Amanda McGarry from Medicine Hat, our grandson Gerald Burdett from Lake Elma.
We're Clarence and Elaine Sanderman from Bowden, Alberta. This cart's myself. I get parts sent to me from the east. I build them to suit what I want or what anybody wants. And I do a lot of competition with them, and I'm very happy to be. And this wagon truck is a test to see how tough they really are.
That's Ted Walls, Brooks, Alberta.
Wolf Catterson, Brooks, Alberta.
I'm Glenn Kidd, I live in Mosley, Alberta.
Kay Kidd, Mosley.
Nick again, Mosley, Alberta.
Thank you.
my room.
Ford or GM commercial here. We've loaded 50,000 pounds in the back of that trailer.
Truck and brake.
Should be using locking chain, guys.
Truck and ready, guys? Ready to get the truck ready.
Take it out of park.
Roll and roll.
He knows what's coming up.
Ha ha ha! Richard Trout.
Beside you. Pony, isn't he? You guys have fun, eh?
Yep. Tells you, hope you know your own video.
Now, my name is Jim Baldock, and I'm from Clarity, Manitoba.
John, this is your grand. This is little Cody, your grandson.
Jerry Sholokowski from Springfield, Manitoba.
Ramona Smolinski from Arbor, Manitoba.
And I'm Francis Gatterstein from Swift Current, Saskatchewan. I used to be from Manitoba.
This is little Corey. That's
Hi, my name is Corey Sholokowski and I'm from Springfield, Manitoba.
Where's Amber?
Hi, I'm Amber Sholokowski and I'm from Springfield, Manitoba.
Watch my pop!
Some of the evening's entertainment was sometimes brought in from great distances. This act, for instance, I think was called Dump All the Water, and the Buckets, and the People, and anything else you can knock down. Oh, good boy. And our local Smith is just hammering away there, filling his pockets full of money, taking advantage of all of them. I better not say too much. He promised to buy several tapes from me if I put them on. Is very nice work. I'm not real handy with that file or rasp. See here, he spun it like that. We had to do several takes before he managed to catch that rasp when he spun it. No, I'm just teasing. He's an excellent Smith and did very nice work and very reasonably priced.
Thank you.
spring of 1873, the tranquility of the Cypress Hills in southern Saskatchewan was shattered by one of the most violent events in the province's history. The Cypress Hills were often visited by the Plains Indians, Assiniboines, Blackfoot, all stopped there for shelter on their wanderings. The Cypress Hills were part of the Whoop-Up country, which encompassed most of southern Saskatchewan, southern Alberta, and all of Montana. The white people in the area were mostly wolfers, fur traders, and whiskey peddlers. For the most part, these men earned their livings trading furs and buffalo robes. Mule trains carried the furs to American merchants at Fort Benton and returned to Saskatchewan laden with blankets, knives, tobacco, and trinkets to the trading post. It was the whiskey peddlers combined with the ravages of European disease that were destroying the Plains Indians. The whiskey trade had expanded northward from Montana, in part because of increased American law enforcement and the lack of law enforcement on the Canadian side of the border. There was also a disregard for the welfare of the Indians by most white men of the day. It was in this that Little Soldier came with his band of 300 Assiniboines, 50 of whom were warriors. The bitter winter and near starvation has forced them to cross 200 miles of frozen prairie to seek food and shelter in the Cypress Hills. As the band entered the Cypress Hills, they also entered the domain of the whiskey peddlers and the traders. Abe Farwell, trader for the T.C. Power and Brothers Company of Fort Benton, operating in cooperation with a number of other traders like George Hammond and Moses Sullivan. Sullivan ran a trading post across the creek from Farwell's post. The Assiniboines made their camp close to these traders and 13 other traders that were within 3 miles of their main camp. There were two other groups in the area. One was the Wolfers, who were very unpopular among the Assiniboines because of their practice of poisoning buffalo carcasses and collecting the pelts of wolves that came to feed on them. The Indians cared little about the wolves, but also about the loss of their valuable dogs that died from eating the poisoned carcasses. The second group, though they played no part in the incident, were the Métis. They lived as hunters and traders in all parts of the Northwest. They were on good terms with the Plains Indians and wintered with them in Moose Mountain, Wood Mountain, and the Cypress Hills.
George Mellish from Assiniboine, Saskatchewan. I got my team of quarter horses. They're 12 and 11 years old. They're having a real good trip.
Beth Seibel Hodgeville.
And Don Reinecke Hodgeville.
Bert Seibel Hodgeville.
The guy that owns the team.
Calvin Arthurs from British Alberta.
I'm Larry Boyd from Longview, Alberta. Robin and I are together on this trip. This is our pack horse, Gumby.
Yara from Lethbridge. I'm with Orville Svennis from Holhurst on a wagon.
In the early days before the tragedy, several events contributed to the deep tension that already existed between the Indians and the whites. There had been trouble between the Blackfoot and the Assiniboine. A few weeks earlier, and a white trader had been killed by the Indians. A group of Assiniboines camped across the creek from Sullivan's trading post was in a surly mood. After some questionable dealings with Sullivan, they felt they had been cheated and fired shots into his post. Farwell wasn't having any problems with the Assiniboines. Some of them had worked for him and even recovered a horse that had been stolen by a passing war party. They were rewarded for this act with liquor by George Hamilton, owner of the stolen horse. His biggest concern was a group of wolfers that had camped near his post. They were a mix of American and Canadians led by horse thieves John Evans and Thomas Hardwick. The Wolfers were angry men as they sat in their camp drinking heavily. Only a short time before, on a trip to Fort Benton with their winter catch, a band of Cree Indians had stolen 40 horses of theirs. Not far away in their camp, the Assiniboines were drinking liquor. The situation was ready to explode. Farwell was in a frightened state. He sent a warning to the Assiniboines that the Wolfers could cause trouble at any moment. The Assiniboines ignored the warning as the liquor made them careless. It was at this worst possible time that Hammond discovered his horse had been stolen again. He was sure the Assiniboines had stolen the horse and went to the Wolfers to help him seize some of the Indians' horses in retaliation. The Wolfers were more than ready to help. The Wolfers moved to the Indian camp and took up a protected position for small food.
Manitoba.
Jim Taylor, Morden.
I'm Jones Taylor from Morden, Manitoba, Canada.
Right on. You having fun on that pony?
Yeah.
What's it?
Jack and Maureen Halpern from Empress, Alberta. Wanted to see what the Cypress Country was like for riding.
Robert Hansen, Sea Lawn, Saskatchewan, wagon boss on this trip. And thank you.
Trevor LaValle, Cadillac, Saskatchewan.
Chris LaValle, Curtis Gerard, Pontiac, Saskatchewan.
Helen Blow, Pontiac, Saskatchewan.
Chad Gerard, Pontiac, Saskatchewan.
I'm Alice Hannah from Pontiac, Saskatchewan.
Roger Hanson, Regina, and I'm the ambulance driver on this trip.
Larry Gerard, Pontiac, commander of the Blue Group.
Yolande Gerard, Pontiac.
Bernadette Oje, Mistro.
Rita Nordwick. I'm part of the emergency team for this group from the wagon train.
Irene LaValle, Cadillac.
Helena Haddon, Pontiac.
Carol Mastro and Al Marie, I'm part of the emergency team as well.
Justin Haddon, Pontiac. Charles LaValle, Cadillac.
Reynaldo Cardoso from Mexico, adopted by this family, and the official obstetrician of this group.
Dennis Calgary.
My name is Chantal.
Who's it? What's your brother's name?
Wayne.
Sammy!
My name is Jenna.
Sherry Shapley. Green Dawson.
Mike Shapley, Katie Valley, Alberta.
Ed Sims from Okanagan Falls, B.C.
Carl Britton, Aylesham, Saskatchewan.
Gord Clausen from Aylesham also.
John Sinclair, love.
Taken to Solomon's Post, among them little chief's wife. Here she and other young women were repeatedly raped. Next morning, the Wolfers buried their only casualty, Ed LaGrasse, under the floor of Farewell Post, burned it and Solomon's to the ground, then hurriedly left. News of the slaughter was 3 months reaching Ottawa, and even then came via the U.S. mail. Well, there was indignation over the fact that defenseless Canadian Indians, women, children, and others were murdered by the U.S. renegades, McDonald still held back his recruit schedule. Then on September 20th, he received a telegram from the needling Lieutenant Governor Morris. What have you done as the police force? Their absence may lead to grave disaster. This time, the Prime Minister acted. On September 25th, 1873, the first officers were appointed and recruiting began for 150 men. The lowest rank sub-constable was to receive 75 cents a day, rations and clothing, and a free grant of 160 acres in the Northwest Territories on the satisfactory completion of his 3-year enlistment. In early October, the new recruits, only two of whom had been policemen, left Ontario for Lower Fort Garry, about 20 miles north of today's Winnipeg. They traveled in comfort by lake steamer to the lakehead of Lake Superior, then challenged some 450 miles of the route established by the fur traders. It consisted mostly of rivers and lakes and included dozens of portages, some up to 2 miles long. The recruits passed their first test well. When they arrived at the fur trading post, the Winnipeg Manitoban reported, "Judging from the first detachment, the Mounted Police are a fine body of men." But when the force's temporary commander, Lieutenant Colonel W. Osborne Smith, swore in the men, he must have wondered about the potential effectiveness of the fine body of men. Most were without uniforms, arms, or other gear because everything had been frozen in between Fort Garry and Lake Superior. Worse than that, most of the horses were unbroke, with few of the recruits able to ride anything more than a vigorous rocking chair. Despite these problems, training started immediately. The routine was brutal, from revelry at 6 a.m., changed to 6:30 during the coldest winter months. Until long after dark, the recruits participated in foot drill, marksmanship, riding, stable cleaning, and other duties. In charge of the breaking of the horses and teaching recruits to ride was Sergeant Major Samuel B. Steele, destined to become one of the most famous of the Mounties. He later wrote, "The orders were that if the temperature were not to drop lower than 36 below zero, the riding and breaking should go on. With very few exceptions, the horses were broncos, with which never been handled, and even when we had them gentled so as to let the recruits mount, the men were repeatedly thrown with great violence to the frozen ground, but no one lost his nerve." Sure, none of us, in all honesty, can say, "I'm sorry I missed that."
Bill?
Oh, real good.
Yeah? Yep. Not getting too sore?
No?
No.
That's good, I do.
I get toughened up.
Yeah.
Ahead of time, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah. I ride every day, I'm so brainy or something.
Still got the old girl with you? That puts her just about the same age as you then.
Well, yeah, that'll be just coming about the same. I'll be 82 and she'll be 81.
Yeah, well, it's sure good to see you back.
All right.
Ken Talbot from Big Creek.
Mitchell Smith from Leader.
Chris Smith from Ken.
Allison Lane from Leader.
Bob Lane from Leader.
Tyler Smith from Madtown.
I'm Clint Yockey from Talking to
you. Julian Yockey from Talking
to you. McKay, come from Inwood, Manitoba.
Jim Rubin.
Despite all the tragedies, the force continued its pressure on the whiskey peddlers. By the spring of 1875, the trade had declined abruptly from a flourishing enterprise to a minor nuisance. Without a shock, the policemen had swiftly accomplished their primary mission and built their outpost at Fort McLeod at the same time. In forthcoming years, the Mounted Police completed the third of their initial objectives, overseeing the peaceful settlement of hundreds of thousands of people on 1,000 miles of Western Plains. The biggest challenge to this peace began in 1876 when the warlike Sioux retreated into Canada after slaughtering Lieutenant Colonel George Armstrong Custer and his entire 7th Cavalry. Eventually, there were some 6,000 Sioux in the Cypress Hills under Chief Sitting Bull, with only a few redcoats under Superintendent Walsh to control them. Despite massive problems, they succeeded, and by 1881, all of the Indians had returned to the United States. During the Riel Rebellion, the Mounties served with distinction, among them Sam Steele, who commanded a group of cowboy veterans and policemen called Steele Scouts. Among those who died fighting the rebels was John French, Commissioner George French's brother, who had been resigned from the force in 1883 and was an officer in the militia. But so little did Ottawa's bureaucrats and politicians appreciate the efforts of the police that while all citizen soldiers received medals within 1 year, they had to wait 3 years. However, those men who had been scouts and were usually the first to be shot at weren't permitted medals. According to the politicians, safely out of range in the east, they hadn't been in action, even though their companions had been wounded and killed. Ironically, there would have been no uprising if Prime Minister Sir John A. Macdonald and the rest of the politicians had heeded the warning of the police and others and settled the just grievances of the Indians and the Métis. A campaign ribbon wasn't the only example of shabby treatment. In 1879, the policemen's pay were virtually halved, and a sub-constable's wage was reduced from 75 cents a day to 40 cents, and not returned to 75 cents for over a quarter century. As a further insult, the free grant of 160 acres at the end of a satisfactory enlistment was canceled. Uniforms were not replaced, and on their cut-rate wages, the men had to borrow money and pay interest to feed and clothe themselves. Among the clothing all men bought were Stetson cowboy hats, since the pillbox types were useless for Western weather. They always have a little entertainment, afternoon entertainment for everybody. And it's appreciated. Yet despite the shabby treatment, the men worked faithfully to uphold the motto of the force, maintain the right. Among their duties in the 1980s, for instance, was protecting tens of thousands of prairie settlers, most of whom had never been out of the city. Hazards were fires which swept the plains with the speed of galloping horses, blizzards which made venturing from the house to the barn perilous, injury, illness, and a host of other potentially dangerous situations. To help safeguard them, every inhabitant was listed a regular patrol started. Each settler signed a patrol sheet when a Mountie checked. The area covered by horseback and by buggy was awesome. In 1 year, out of Regina alone, patrols traveled nearly 350,000 miles, a distance equivalent to 4 times around the world and a side trip to the moon. George A. French had also fought for better conditions for his men. In 1874, he refused to make the new post at Swan River his headquarters as ordered, since he felt that the barracks were unfit to live in. Because of continuing clash with the politicians, he resigned in 1876. When he left, his men collected money and presented him with a $200 gold watch and chain, and his wife with a set of silver plate. He continued his career in the British Army, became a major general, and was eventually knighted. French summarized his feelings towards the men he commanded on the march and for their accomplishments in his December 1874 report. A Canadian force, hastily raised, armed and equipped, and not under martial law, in a few months marched 2,000 miles through a country for the most part as unknown, as it proved bare of pasture and scanty in its water supply. Of such a march, under such conditions, all true Canadians may well feel proud.
Hey there, hey there, hey there! Thank you.
Part of the Boundary Commission wagon train.